turmoil in Baltimore, beginning with a portion of President Obama's extensive remarks on the topic this afternoon in the Rose Garden.
When individuals get crowbars and start prying open doors to loot, they're not protesting. They're not making a statement. They're stealing. When they burn down a building, they're committing arson. And they're destroying and undermining businesses and opportunities in their own communities that rob jobs and opportunity from people in that area. The violence that happened yesterday distracted from the fact that you had seen multiple days of peaceful protests that were focused on entirely legitimate concerns of these communities in Baltimore, led by clergy and community leaders, and they were constructive and they were thoughtful. And frankly, didn't get that much attention. And one burning building will be looped on television over and over and over again, and the thousands of demonstrators who did it the right way, I think, have been lost in the discussion. What I'd say is, this has been a slow-rolling crisis. This has been going on for a long time. This is not new. And we shouldn't pretend that it's new. The good news is that perhaps there's some newfound awareness because of social media and video cameras and so forth that there are problems and challenges when it comes to how policing and our laws are applied in certain communities, and we have to pay attention to it and respond. If we are serious about solving this problem, then we're going to not only have to help the police, we're going to have to think about what can we do, the rest of us, to make sure that we're providing early education to these kids, to make sure that we're reforming our criminal justice system so it's not just a pipeline from schools to prisons, so that we're not rendering men in these communities unemployable because of a felony record for a nonviolent drug offense, that we're making investments so that they can get the training they need to find jobs. That's hard. That requires more than just the occasional news report or task force. That's how I feel. I think there are a lot of good-meaning people around the country that feel that way, but that kind of political mobilization, I think we haven't seen in quite some time. And what I've tried to do is to promote those ideas that would make a difference, but I think we all understand that the politics of that are tough because it's easy to ignore those problems or to treat them just as a law and order issue as opposed to a broader social issue.
Less than a month ago, all eyes were on North Charleston, South Carolina, where another police department was under fire in the unexplained death of yet another black man. Republican Senator Tim Scott of South Carolina, one of only two African Americans in the Senate, is also saying things have to change. I met him at his Capitol Hill office earlier today to talk about it. Senator, thank you for joining us.
Yes, ma'am.
As you watch everything that's being unfolding in Baltimore, does it remind you at all about North Charleston and Walter Scott situation?
The images that I see in Baltimore are very different than what I experienced at home in North Charleston for several reasons. One reason is that we had a video. Second reason, there was quick action and an arrest. And third is that the mother of the victim was very clear in asking for peace and sharing in her heart that the forgiveness that resided in her heart for the officer.
There are two things at work here. On one hand, there is the reaction to the incident.
Yes.
And then there's the incident itself. If there had not been video, you seem to suggest what would have happened later didn't happen. And there is still uncertainty about what happened in Baltimore to Freddie Gray after he was arrested. So you are talking about body cameras. How
Absolutely.
Would that get to the bottom of this?
Well, I tell you, there's no doubt that body-worn cameras are effective tools to making sure that justice is done, that clarity and transparency are available. I think it also helps to reduce the number of complaints against law enforcement officers, and it also, some studies, reduces the amount of violence and or force used by officers by 60%. So the result of officers wearing cameras have been very positive, and the information that continues to come in reinforces the fact that body-worn cameras are a positive tool in law enforcement and bringing the community and the police together.
But does it bother you at all that it's even necessary, that in order to protect people from inappropriate police violence, that you need the videotapes? Isn't there a root problem here?
Well, there certainly are a lot of things to consider. One thing we know for sure is that those cameras do help. I would suggest that the vast majority of law enforcement officers every single day work with integrity, the highest level of character, but it's finding the bad apple that spoils the whole bunch. One thing that a camera does is it captures, and very often the information that it captures is indisputable. What we need today, more than ever before, is indisputable evidence that leads to conclusions that can be reinforced by the very evidence that we have. So I don't know that what we're seeing today is brand new as much as it is being brought to the surface because of the cameras.
Does the federal government have a responsibility to address the root causes? People say it's unemployment, that it's anger after years of being profiled, stereotyped. Whatever you think the reason behind all of this is, does the federal government have a role?
I think the nation as a whole has a role in making sure that each individual, each citizen maximizes one's potential. And so we all have a role in that. As it relates to the federal government taking over local law enforcement issues, I don't think that we should, I don't think that we can, and I don't think that we will. But having a role to play in making sure that we use the positions that we have to bring peace and transparency throughout the nation is very, very necessary. As a kid who failed out of high school as a freshman, I know firsthand and personally that sense of hopelessness and just being drifting in the wrong direction, having really no hope. Being able to harness that frustration was incredibly valuable in my life. And that's one of the reasons why I focus so consistently on the foundation of education, because it helps to eviscerate those things, the unemployment, high dropout rates, poverty. It's as close to magic as you can get in America, education.
You voted against the confirmation of Loretta Lynch.
Yes.
Is there any role that she should play now?
Well, certainly, congratulations. She is our Attorney General. We look forward to working with her. She has said that she stands ready and prepared to be of some assistance when necessary. I think at this point that the state and the city are trying their best to handle the situation. I think upon request, the federal government can play a role if necessary. But at this point, the city and the state have been able to work together, and we've seen the deployment of National Guard units are being at least prepared to go in.
You are obviously a black man, only two African-American men in the Senate. I wonder if you were the child you talked about before who could have gone off on a bad path, whether you would expect more of government in this kind of situation.
I think people, especially being that kid before, have been that kid just a couple years ago. I use that term loosely, obviously. The fact of the matter is that kids look for hope. They look for inspiration. It doesn't have to come from the government, frankly. It just has to come. And for me, it came from the form of a mentor, a Chick-fil-A operator who invested the last 4 years of his life, he died at 38, in creating the first 4 years of my new life. So the fact of the matter is that hope comes from many sources. I think depending on the federal government to be some sort of a savior is false hope.
Let's take the government out of it. Just as a community leader, you've met with the community leaders in Ferguson. You have obviously met with the ones in North Charleston. You're watching very closely as this unfolds in Baltimore. What should we as a society be thinking, be doing on behalf of the pain, to solve some of the pain we see arising in these communities?
I guess my three P's would be pray. Pray first. Second, prepare. And then persist. Let me talk about the persist first. Persisting to me means that today is a day for full engagement. We have to be persistent in engaging those folks in the community who have the ability to influence others. It's very difficult from the outside to come into a community and make a difference. But it was very easy for me as a North Charleston native to sit down and talk to community leaders, to pastors, to young people about what was happening. So being persistent is very, very helpful. we have to also prepare. Part of preparation is understanding how do you avoid circumstances that we're seeing unfold. That's why the body cameras are important from my perspective. It prepares us in advance of a crisis. Another part of preparation is looking at the educational outcome of the kids in the neighborhoods. When you have high unemployment, you have low graduation rates, you're starting to see the formation of challenging circumstances, especially when it's steeped in poverty. So we can do something about those issues on the local level, on the state level, and on the federal level. We can unleash American capitalism in such a way that it helps to become headwinds to things that are destructive. We can be a force for good.
Senator Tim Scott, thank you very much.
Yes, ma'am. Good to be with you.